We have another episode talking about the glass, but let's talk about the joinery, the framing, the things that hold that glass from the outside, the head, the sill, and the jambs of a window. And when we're talking about a window, we have a few different criteria to talk about. We have the material, what that frame is made out of, the profile, the shape of it, how it kind of fits into things, the detailing, the operability, the membranes and tapes and things like that that might go in, the air seals. There's all kinds of different things that are involved with installing a window that aren't just the frame itself. And then we could also talk about the testing, both in the lab to prove that something works, and then on site to prove that that thing that you proved works in a lab also has been installed properly on site. So with that being said, let's get into it. Now, when you're specifying a window, the first thing to think about is the material. Are you going to go with something that you're generally used to? Aluminium is probably the most common for, let's say, commercial, residential here in New Zealand. Would you go with a thermally broken aluminium to get a certain thermal efficiency or a certain R value? Do you go with a different metal for a certain look? A steel window, a stainless steel window, a galvanized steel window, a bronze even? Or do you go UPVC because you want that maximum thermal performance while also getting a pretty kind of slick look and good air tightness? Timber is another option. A lot of us are used to those on older houses, villas, and things like that. But there are newer versions that have really good air tightness, really, you know, fancy looking, sometimes with aluminium covers on the outside to increase that durability. Fiberglass is a thing that is available. I know it's available in North American market. Not sure if it's here in New Zealand yet, but extruding that fiberglass to make a very thermally efficient but very strong frame is an option. When you're going to decide, it really helps to think about what the look you want to go for is, the thermal efficiency, and the hardware and performance aspects, and what your client or the occupant of the building is going to interact with. So it helps to think of the strengths of each material, the look of each material, and kind of balancing that out to get something that performs really well, looks really good, feels really nice to the occupant, and gets you the best bang for buck when it comes to windows. Now, once the material has been decided, then we move on to the shape or the profile. Different materials will have different shapes and different profiles, but if we can kind of categorize them out into a few different subcategories, we have a flanged frame, which is what we're all generally used to. Older aluminium profiles will always have that frame, that flange around the end that kind of covers either the rab board or the cladding. The other option would be a rectangular or flat-sided frame, and that would be able to be installed from the inside, which is nice because you don't have that flange on the outside. It allows you to recess the window as well. So if you have a good thermally broken or very high-performing window, you want to put that in line with your insulation. So generally, you probably want a rectangular-edged frame and then set that back inside your wall a little. In addition to that, there's other fancy things like curved glass and curved framing. I would not recommend going with that unless you have a very specific look. There are ways to simulate, I guess, rounded facades with individual square or flat panels. So I would recommend that, but hey, there are curved options as well if you need it. And then in terms of the actual system itself, we generally have punched windows where you have an opening in a wall, you put the window in that. Pretty straightforward. But then we also have things like curtain wall. Curtain wall is a window system that hangs on the outside of the floor structure of a building. And so it hangs from above and is panels of full glass. If you've ever seen a building that is basically glass from top to bottom, most likely that's curtain wall. But with curtain wall, there are two different ways to build that. Either it can be unitized, where it comes to site in big rectangular panels with the glass, possibly some cladding involved. That gets lifted into place and set into place on the facade. But the other option is stick built. So all the individual components, the horizontal mullions, the vertical mullions, and the glass, all of those get installed piece by piece on site. So it's a little bit slower and will need a little bit more workmanship, but for a certain project where you have tight constraints, can't get a crane involved, for whatever reason you can't get those panels in, stick built might be the better choice. In North America, there's also something called window wall, which is very similar to curtain wall in that there's glass from floor to ceiling, but instead of hanging from each floor, it's sitting on each floor. The gravity is going onto the bottom of it, and it's kind of within the floor plate as opposed to hanging outside of it. And then there's also skylights if you ever want any roof lighting. Skylights are a thing. They are a little bit more involved or a little bit more risky than a window because it is a horizontal or sloped surface as opposed to a vertical. But there are ways to detail it. And generally, you want to have good air tightness, you want to have redundancy, you want to have drains that drain properly. Basically, the same concept for windows. We'll get into those detailing aspects. But with a skylight, because it is basically becoming a roof, it is a much higher risk because it's getting a lot more wind, rain, etc. exposure. So let's get into the operability. Now that we've gotten the profile, we've gotten the material, the next thing to think about is the operability. Do we need these windows to open or do they just stay fixed in place? The easiest detailing and generally the most robust is going to be a fixed window because you don't have those moving parts to deal with. But there are many buildings where you want to have those windows openable to allow some breeze, allow someone to stick their head out if they need to, whatever it might be. So operability is an important factor in window design. Fixed, that's the easiest one, stays in place, doesn't open, doesn't close. Then when you're going to operable windows, the typical one that we see day to day are awning windows. They open out from the bottom and kind of slope outwards. Makes a lot of sense. Rain hits it, deflects off of it. I get it. Other options that are fairly common in North America are casement windows. They open from the side outwards. There's also ones that open from the side inwards. There's sliding. They slide side to side. Usually you'll see big, large sliding doors that are like that. Less common for windows, but they do exist. There are single and double hung. Those slide upwards and downwards. There's a hopper window, which leans in from the top. So you open it up and then it kind of tilts inwards. It works very similar to an awning window because the water deflects outwards, but it opens in instead of out, which is a little bit strange, but very, very popular in Europe, especially in a tilt and turn type window where you turn the handle one way, it opens up a little bit for ventilation, and then you turn the handle a little bit more, it opens up. You can wash the outside from the interior, which is pretty cool. Close up the window again. There's jalousie louvers, just small pieces of glass that kind of fit together. Some of them are gasketed, some of them are not. Not really my favorite window because they're not very airtight, not very weather tight. In like windy and stormy situations, but they can be very good for certain buildings where you're not really looking for all of that weather tightness. But when it comes to detailing, when it comes to choosing these operables, it really serves to go and play with examples, play with mock-ups, go into a warehouse, into a showroom from your supplier and go, you know, turn the handles, open the windows, slide the sliding doors, feel how they feel and compare and contrast between different suppliers. Because the hardware matters. It looks a certain way, but it also feels a certain way. It will close that window tighter. That'll deaden more sound from outside, might make it more weather tight, might make it more durable long term. I'm sure we've all seen those windows where a little tab comes off and then it doesn't really quite close tightly anymore. So hardware definitely matters. Gaskets, seals, brushes, hinges, handles, any of those different things. Multiple locking points on a window is a big, big thing that holds things a lot tighter, therefore a lot more airtight. Whereas if it's only held in one point, maybe you're not quite getting that that airtightness. When it comes to operability, it really pays to think about what your occupant of your building is going to experience, what you want them to experience, and then which window and which operability will make that happen and make it a much nicer place for that occupant to be without doing extra work in terms of detailing. Now, getting into the detailing, there's a few different things that kind of need to be decided upon. Where in the wall do we want that glass surface to be? Do we want it to be right next to the cladding? Do we want it to be recessed? Do we want it to be punched outwards, hypothetically? And from there, you'll be able to think about the actual details behind that window before it's installed into that rough opening. Now, the rough opening itself always should be fully taped, nice and airtight and protecting the timber or whatever material is in the substrate. And especially at the sills, that is very, very important. You want a nice watertight, vapor tight, vapor closed tape with good upturns so that if any water does hypothetically leak through or around the window, it'll hit that tape and go outwards. When it comes to the airtightness of a window, there's a few different ways to do it. Generally, we'll see sealant joints around that flange between the rough opening and a timber liner. There are there's room for improvement there, but we'll get into that a little bit later. But there's two different options. You could either have that seal, that sealant seal, a wet seal around your perimeter, or it could be a taped seal. Some suppliers have done some testing with some tapes, makes it a little bit quicker and easier to install. Now, the other option that I have seen is spray foam insulation sprayed around that perimeter. And while that might be okay when it first gets installed, a lot of times it'll kind of expand and contract and crack a little bit. So it's not very airtight long term. So you could put that foam inside that rough opening just for insulation purposes, but you still want to have an air seal, a redundant air seal on the interior side. When it comes to that air seal, there are parts of the window, typical windows, that aren't very airtight. That is usually the miter joints at corners, which tend to kind of flex around when windows are coming to sight. The connection between the aluminium and the timber liner is usually unsealed. Those corners of timber are also unsealed. So to make those airtight, you kind of have to go a little bit over and above the building code and add some air tightness. Some options are delivering the windows to site just with the aluminium, no timber liner, and putting the seal on the aluminium instead of the timber. Or you can join that aluminium and timber together with a full tape strip around the perimeter. And then once you put your air seal in there, it's sealing between the tape of the window and the tape of the rough opening. So you have that continuity. Now, when it comes to fixings, they can either go through those timber liners if you've made them airtight. It could also go through the aluminium flange if there's space there. I tend to not like to trust the timber to aluminium staples. I like to trust actual aluminium with screws through it, but there are scenarios where going through the timber liners does make sense. Now, once that window is in, it's in that rough opening, you figured out how far in or out you want it to be recessed. Next, we start to think about the flashings, the deflection, the covering pieces. Do you need soaker flashings behind? The head flashing should have stop ends, should be a little bit outside the window. There's a few detailing things to do, and it kind of really depends on the profile itself and the surroundings, the adjacent cladding, how they all go together. So hard to really give definitive things right now, but let us know and we'll be able to help you with that. But there are certain things to look at. There is pressure equalization. If you have pockets inside the frame that allow air to expand and equalize that pressure, what it does is it provides back pressure, which forces a little bit water out or kind of prevents it from coming in, if that makes any sense. And it also breaks any capillary action. If you have things that are too close together, water can kind of climb up meters and kind of go in different places, which is not what you want. So pressure equalization and drainage pathways is key. And the drainage pathways are really the biggest, I guess, biggest design criteria for weather tightness. If you have good drainage pathways that are staggered from each other so that water can't make its way in, with pressure equalization spaces that are tall enough, you can really get up to large pressures with water coming in under pressure, and it'll still stay dry on the inside. So drainage is key. Making sure those drains are cleaned out during construction, also very important, but less important for design. There's also options for detailing where you can hide the frame either from the inside or the outside or both, where you just see the glass because the frame has been covered by the interior finishes or the exterior cladding. But yeah, it really depends on the look that you're looking for, depends on the profile that you've chosen, the material that you've chosen, the glass, et cetera, how it all works together. But there's certain things for detailing that you want to get. And yeah, drainage, pressurized equalization, and continuity of air, insulation, and water tightness barriers is key. Now, once you've got all the detail sorting, the other thing to check is the testing. Has this window been tested either in a lab? Has it been tested on site? Has it been tested structurally for weather tightness, whatever it might be? Now, when it comes to testing here in New Zealand, there are some, you know, common tests that we'll see: NZS4211, NZS4284, VM1, VM2, all these different things that you might have heard of. But what it really is a lab test that sprays water at a window and the surrounding wall, hypothetically, sprays water, sprays air, has a pressure difference between inside and outside. And what that does is it simulates a storm scenario and simulates what this window might experience in the real world. Once you have a design, you have the profiles chosen, you should also be checking the testing. Has this window been tested? Some have, some haven't, most have. Some very specific bespoke ones probably haven't. But what the testing does, the lab testing, is it tests that window against SLS deflection, ULS deflection, basically the movement. Is it strong enough? Does it keep the water out? Is it airtight enough? All these different tests kind of give a general performance outline for how these windows react in the real world. The lab is in perfect conditions. Someone's in there installing things perfectly, making sure everything is sealed, do a quick little run up, see if anything leaks, fix some stuff, and then do the real test. So when it comes to a lab, that's more of a checkbox type thing for compliance with the building code. Does this window, in theory, in perfect conditions, work to meet the conditions of the building code? Yes or no? Now, with that lab test, you can apply for consent, you can get your building compliant, but when it comes to actually installing those windows in the real world on site, how do we QA? How do we make sure that it's been installed properly and manufactured properly? Well, with a site test. Now, a lab test versus a site test, having both of them might seem like overkill, but they're testing two very different things. One is the theoretical performance, and the other one is the real world performance of that specific window. So once you've gotten compliance with your lab testing, then it gets installed and you test on site to make sure it's been installed properly. And when it comes to testing on site, most of the time they do tend to leak a little bit. But the good thing about that is that everyone's there to fix it. The window manufacturer, the supplier, the contractor, everyone's there, and there's no occupants in the way to allow us to fix things. So you do a site test, something leaks, it gets fixed, you do a retest, it's all good to go, and you go from there. And the occupants, the client, the building owner, the contractor, the installer, everyone gets peace of mind because we've tested these windows with air pressure, with water, making sure they're not leaking when they're installed, so we can trust that durability moving forward. With those types of tests that we see here in New Zealand, there are some other window manufacturers or suppliers that import from overseas. Overseas test standards are very similar in that they test the pressure, they test the strength, they test the weather tightness, but generally the criteria or the testing methodology is a little bit different. So if you want to import some overseas windows, someone needs to translate those overseas test standards to the local test standards to make sure everything works and will be compliant with code. And then once again, even if it is an imported system, you still want to test it on site to make sure what's been installed has been installed properly, manufactured properly, and will not be at risk of leaking prematurely. So hopefully that's given you a good amount of things to think about when designing a window. But if there's any other complicated things, bespoke things, things that don't quite fit together, let us know and we're here to help.